In this video, I want to talk about an article called The Shareholder versus the Stakeholder Debate. It's by Jeff Smith and appeared in MIT's Sloan Management Review in 2003. I want to look at this article as it's one of the few recent articles that does try to contrast the shareholder view of the responsibilities of the firm with the stakeholder view. In recent strategy papers, the focus has tended to take a stakeholder view, often railing against Milton Friedman's essay from 1970, where he asserts that the social responsibility of business is to increase profits. As Bertrand Russell comments, you cannot criticise until you fully understand the argument being put forward. And I am afraid that in some cases this has been so with Friedman's statement. As with his hero Adam Smith, the qualifying statements are often forgotten. As Friedman points out, increasing profits had to be through legal means, engaging in open and fair competition without deception or fraud, is how he puts it. It also speaks to increasing dividends through profitability rather than share price increases. It does not say businesses should not care about social issues. It's saying that society is more effective if we divide the responsibilities and focus institutions onto different parts. So businesses' role is to effectively provide good products and services, provide employment and pay dividends and taxes. This then allows government and others to focus their specialisms on other issues. Friedman's views about the size of government and its role will leave to his followers and another debate. In recent years, the stakeholder view, that is, the firm voluntarily engages in social issues that are beyond its usual operations, has been in ascendancy. Although, as Porter and Kramer suggest, not always resulting in effective social outcomes. However, it is valuable to properly understand both views as they lead to different insights about strategy, even if personally we strongly believe in one of them. Published in the wake of Enron, Jeff Smith's article starts from recent corporate scandals, Enron, Tyco, WorldCom, to name a few, saying that they have proved rich fodder for those questioning shareholder theory and the prime motive of firms to maximise shareholder return. So a victory, it seemed, for the stakeholder theory, which say that managers' duty should be to balance shareholders' financial interests against those interests of other stakeholders, whether that's employees, customers, or the local community. Both views are often misrepresented, and so it'd be useful to have a closer look at what the two of them are actually saying. As Smith says, both are normative theories, i.e., that is, prescribing what corporations' role ought to be, but they are at odds about what they define as the right thing to do. Shareholder theory asserts that as shareholders advance capital to the firm, managers should only spend funds in ways authorised by shareholders. Often this view is mistakenly interpreted in terms that firstly, it's urging managers to do anything to make a profit, despite the obligations clearly made in this view that managers have to stay within the law and not deceive in achieving that aim. Also, the argument goes that it prohibits giving corporate funds to such things as charitable projects or investing in employee morale. While in fact, shareholder theory supports such initiatives if they are, in the end, the best investment of capital that's available. Hence, making decisions by thinking about what is in the interests of shareholders, even if it means running down the business and giving capital back to shareholders. In contrast, stakeholder theory asserts that managers have a duty to both the firm's shareholders and individuals and constituencies who contribute, voluntary or not, to the company's activities, whether gaining benefit of it or shouldering risk. So managers are the agents of all stakeholders and must ensure the ethical rights of no stakeholder is violated and the legitimate interests of stakeholders are balanced in decision making. Now, some assert that these theories are converging, arguing that if managers take care of stakeholders, they will end up maximising profits in the long run. This is certainly an argument put forward by Porter and Kramer in their 2006 article. However, this is clearly not the case in all situations. Jeff Smith uses the example of a manufacturing company in a small Midwestern town that exports its products to many overseas markets, but for the last 10 years does not sell in the US. But when the managers found they can no longer afford to ignore low-cost outsourcing overseas, shareholder theory would support closing the US plant and stick to the legal minimums in support being provided to local community and employees. There is little possibility of a backlash against the company as it only exports. In contrast, the stakeholder view would infer obligation to all stakeholders. Maybe the plant still needs to close, but the firm would be expected to invest in supporting and retraining employees, perhaps also attracting new industry to the town. Actions that do reduce profitability. Very different views on normative behaviour, as you can see. In the end, stakeholder theory demands stakeholder interests are an end in themselves, while shareholder theory argues that stakeholder interests are a means to an end, profitability. In the next section, Smith asks if there has always been a dispute between stakeholder and shareholder views. Interestingly, he argues that the perception is that historically the US economic system was more in line with the stakeholder view. But this has shifted as a result of the argument of free market advocates, such as Milton Friedman, and concerns over whether managers were really acting as the agents of shareholders. So a concern that were engaging in endeavours that were socially beneficial, but not connected to profitability. And so we're reducing shareholder value and also reducing taxes. In the 1980s and 1990s, shareholder value was the increasing focus of corporate boards, at least publicly. This prompted the acceptance that the shareholder view fit more closely with US societal norms. But as Smith points out, evidence of the perceived social norms appear to dispute this. There's a view that US companies had no choice but to follow shareholder theory on the basis of the law and of market forces. Again, Smith urges a closer look, that legal statutes are less clear-cut, Directors have a legal duty of care and a duty of loyalty. So they have a duty to consider necessary information before taking decisions and to act appropriately when there is a conflict of interest. Neither does the evidence suggest that managers are removed if they don't maximise profit. And so the market force is perhaps not as strong as proponents of the shareholder view would have us believe. If anything, boards act more as neutral umpires rather than as the policemen employed by the shareholders. Smith asked the question as to whether the shareholder view is now withering as a result of corporate scandals, as critics claim. The most strident claim that executives charged with maximising shareholder value and that goal being linked to large incentives will respond by embracing whatever manipulations are necessary to achieve that goal. However, Smith argues that this criticism rests on an incomplete understanding and a misrepresentation of shareholder theory. As we have seen, profit maximisation, according to the shareholder view, must be by legal means and without deception. And if we look at the various scandals that have prompted the criticism, the executives who broke the law were not operating according to shareholder theory. Hence, in Smith's view, while the shareholder theory has been tainted by association, it still influences behaviour and thinking within firms. And the dispute between the shareholder view and the stakeholder view is still in the balance. There is still a standoff, as Smith puts it, between the two views. Although the language used to communicate actions and decisions has shifted from maximising shareholder value to maximising the company's value. So let's emphasise on to the shareholder. Smith finishes the paper by commenting that whichever view is embraced, executives need to be clear in their communications. If middle managers are confused about what the corporation's objectives are, they will make inconsistent decisions. So organisations need to understand what they believe the objectives of the firm are and be consistent in their approach as a result. Thank you.